Without a decisive naval force, we can do nothing definitive, and with it, everything honorable and glorious. In the days of sail, war at sea was an intimate affair. On the high seas, men met nearly face to face with cannons, cutlasses, and a very personal sort of bravery. In the days of wooden ships and sails, tactics were limited by technology, but accurate intelligence on an adversary's location and intentions was always imperative and always difficult to obtain. From Greek and Roman oared galleys to the Spanish Armada and Britain's Royal Navy, much had changed in armament and tactics, but there was little change in the methods of gathering information about one's adversary. At sea, only the billowing sails appearing high on the horizon or floating debris would indicate that one's foe was near. To approach each other and engage, ships maneuvered with the wind for hours. Actual combat occurred at ranges of no more than a few hundred yards and lasted hours or sometimes even days. With the coming of our War of Independence, the American Continental Congress began building a small navy and initiated a privateering campaign against British commerce. The small navy was not expected to contest British control of the seas, but rather to harass it, waging hit-and-run strikes against British trade. For the most part, the Continental Navy's fleet of smaller ships, frigates, sloops, brigantines, and schooners, cruised independently or in pairs in search of their prey, avoiding, whenever possible, fights with the Royal Navy's powerful ships of the line. As a result, good operational intelligence was crucial to our Navy from the very first. It was vital to know everything one could about where British merchant ships were and where the men of war weren't. An early example of such intelligence-driven successes occurred in March 1778, when armed with recently acquired intelligence, Commodore John Barry surprised a British flotilla and captured three of its ships using only a motley armada of small craft, including longboats, barges, and rowboats. For this feat, Barry received a personal letter of commendation from George Washington. The Continental Navy became the United States Navy and was soon sailing in harm's way all around the globe. Between 1801 and 1805, for example, the Navy protected U.S. commerce from corsairs in the Mediterranean, not simply conducting patrol and convoy escort duties, but acting aggressively to blockade and bombard the pirate stronghold at Tripoli. With such a global role, however, came an increased need for global intelligence, a challenge that the U.S. Navy had trouble meeting until technological change made possible a revolution in the collection and dissemination of intelligence information. Not until World War II would modern naval intelligence truly come into its own. With the advent of modern weaponry, propulsion systems, and radio communications, the naval battle space expanded quickly from hundreds of yards in the age of sail to hundreds of nautical miles during World War II. Where once one could only engage the enemy within the reach of an old smoothbore cannon, by 1941 it was possible to strike hundreds of miles away with a deadly fleet of carrier-borne aircraft. With such developments, the fast-paced tempo of naval operations made accurate and timely information even more crucial to theater commanders. Providing commanders with information on the immediate location and activity of the enemy has always been the greatest responsibility of any military intelligence professional in wartime. With 20th century technology, meeting this challenge became more vital than ever in peacetime as well as war. The most deadly long-range weapons are of little danger to the enemy unless one knows where to point them. without skilled intelligence professionals who can filter and fuse masses of incoming data into a form the warfighter can act upon in time to win, the operational commander is largely blind, and the most elaborate information collection system is pointless. This is what the program you are watching is all about: operational intelligence and the crucial relationship between the intelligence professional and the warfighter. In the next few minutes, you will hear directly from some of the U.S. Navy's most illustrious intelligence officials and operational commanders. You will hear in their own words about their experiences and about the lessons they have learned during their combined 400 years of naval intelligence experience from Pearl Harbor through the dawn of the post-Cold War era. Let's start at the most fundamental level. What is operational intelligence, or op intel? In a nutshell, it is providing the warfighter with the right information about the enemy's location and activity at the right time in a rapidly developing operational setting. Good operational intelligence has always been important in warfare, but modern naval op intel was for many years unique in its scope and sophistication. Necessity is the mother of invention, as the saying goes, and the Navy's approach to op intel was forced upon it by trying circumstances. The attack on Pearl Harbor, Hawaii by the Imperial Japanese Navy on December 7, 1941, presented the U.S. Navy with an unprecedented crisis, one that required the utmost and timely, relevant operational intelligence on the Japanese fleet. The Japanese striking force had appeared seemingly out of nowhere and wreaked havoc upon the U.S. Pacific Fleet. Where was it now? What would it do next? And how could we prepare ourselves to combat it? At first, these were questions that had no answers. Japan's hopes, therefore, rested upon being able to press forward to maximum advantage before the U.S. could muster a response. America's hopes, in turn, depended upon being able to buy time by blunting the Japanese onslaught using inferior forces. Lacking an advantage in ships, the U.S. Navy had to seize and maintain an advantage in operational intelligence. It had to fight smarter than the Imperial Navy.
Immediately after the commencement of the war, the Naval Security Group stations and personnel dedicated themselves to a very major effort to make progress fast in the basic Japanese Navy operational communications system, which came to be known as JN-25. That was our designation of their primary system. And within a very few months, they made substantial progress in recovering additional code groups and being able to read many messages with a fair degree of intelligence, fair degree of text, so that by April of 1942, we were able to give warning to Admiral Nimitz about the advent of the movement by the Japanese toward New Guinea and what developed as the Battle of the Coral Sea.
U.S. Navy modern operational intelligence was born in this crucible, quickly maturing by taking advantage of its code-breaking successes and of an organizational form of all-source analysis cells pioneered by the British Admiralty during its own long and trying battle against German U-boats in the Atlantic. Underlying the fierce war between Allied battle fleets and their German and Japanese opponents was thus another war, an intelligence war. The intelligence adversaries might not meet face to face, but they duel constantly in their efforts to make better and faster use of the information racing through the airwaves high above the Pacific and Atlantic oceans.
When the Japanese organized the attack on Midway Island, we were able to read enough of the Japanese messages that we could deliver to Admiral Nimitz essentially the complete op order that the Japanese commander-in-chief gave to his forces to organize and execute the move against Midway, which resulted in the Battle of Midway, where Admiral Nimitz had very inferior forces to the Japanese force, but we succeeded through surprise to gain the advantage in the Battle of Midway, and we sank 4 major carriers in one day.
The revealing messages not only provided a warning about the type of battle to expect on Midway, but it also gave SINGPAC planners excellent insight in formulating their plans to defend the island.
We didn't have great detail on that battle, but we had enough information that he was able to deploy ships and confront the Japanese. And that actually was our first victory in World War II.
When the Japanese began to implement their Midway plans using extensive war games and communications exercises, its naval radio communications became virtual mirrors of their intentions to those who knew how to interpret them. Such analyses could, in turn, become vital operational intelligence to U.S. commanders who received it in time to put it to use in surprising and defeating the Japanese attack.
We knew we had a commodity that was of use to the operating forces. It could only be useful if we could get it to the operating forces properly interpreted so they would understand it and be able to take action on it. And that became the basis of Op Intel. There were no other good sources of information. In fact, in the early part of the war, there were no other sources of information. We were able to distribute this information, disseminate the information to the forces that needed it in time for them to use it. That's another important element of Op Intel, to have reliable information properly interpreted, put into the hands of the man that can use it in time for him to use it. And that was the birth and evolution of Op Intel during World War II.
A lot of people think it means automatically throwing data in from different sources and all, and it comes out like sausages. In point of fact, we have been practicing all source fusion in the Navy, naval intelligence, for some time. And I think we did that very effectively during the Cold War, and it's given us, a capability that has been transferred to the other services, the joint arena and so forth. It's a matter of taking advantage of all of the information that's available and working it together so that you can validate or invalidate certain information.
The Navy's elaborate system for winning the Op Intel War didn't survive 1945, but with the advent of the Cold War with the Soviet Union soon thereafter, U.S. intelligence professionals had a powerful model to build upon. For the Navy, Op Intel was less a particular way of providing intelligence than it was a mindset or a culture. It was the living out of a deep appreciation for the need to collect information from as wide a variety of sources as possible, to analyze it, and to get the results to operational commanders in time to be useful.
The underpinning of all of that, and the thing we need to scratch down to, is that those structures and approaches allowed us to be successful in an era where we needed off-board support. We had a very specific set of needs. We were focused and very appropriately on the problems that were relevant to the needs of our operators at the time. It had nothing to do with the structure. It had everything to do with the relevance.
If you go to your operational brethren or your operational boss and you give him an intelligence briefing and he says, well, that's interesting, but how does it help me hit the target today or find the submarine this afternoon or interdict the weapons shipment tomorrow, it's interesting but not very useful. So when the operator or the warfighter has taken what you have provided to him and is able to use it to conduct his mission, that's operational intelligence. And I think it's very broad because the missions of our military and the missions of the Navy are very broad.
In continual peacetime operational contact with the same Soviet forces that would be its adversaries in war, the U.S. Navy faced unique challenges during the Cold War and a unique opportunity to hone sophisticated wartime-style op intel methods even in times of peace. This helped the Navy develop a unique and highly successful op intel philosophy.
We operate inside and among our opponent. The Army operates, or did, in a FIBA. And they were on this side and the opponents on that side. So there was no, I mean, you can look around and over, but you weren't living with the guy. Submarine Force has been doing it that way for years, attack air, and the Navy has been doing it that way for years, and of course the surface side has been doing it that way for years. The Air Force, by the nature of the way they do business, tend to obliterate the opposition or not be engaged in it. In other words, their mission is over somebody else's airspace. So when they go in, they eliminate the opposition. So they don't have very much hands-on interaction like we did with the Libyan fighters.
General Graham, who was director of DIA in the 70s, an Army lieutenant general, had a saying that I'm very fond of. He said, the Army and the Air Force sit in their garrisons and every once in a while come out and exercise. The Navy is out there in no man's land, day in, day out, going eyeball to eyeball with the enemy. And this is coming from an Army general, incidentally. And he really believed it. And of course, nothing could be more true than that. We were out there, eyeball to eyeball, with the Soviet Navy. It was particularly true, of course, of our submarines, but it was true of the whole Navy. And this gave us wonderful opportunity to learn, to develop, and to become experts in operational intelligence.
Most of all, this experience gave Navy operators and intelligence professionals an unparalleled opportunity to learn how to work together effectively and to trust each other completely while in daily contact with the adversary.
It's one of the differences between naval intelligence officers and, frankly, intelligence officers raised elsewhere. I wish I could bottle the culture and take it. The Navy isn't perfect, but it does it more consistently than the other services, at least that I've seen. This integration, maybe it's because they're on ships together. They eat dinner together and they are in the flag mess and they can't avoid each other. A ship's a small little world.
I think Colin Powell was the one that was famous for saying, tell me what you know, tell me how much confidence you have in it, tell me what you don't know. In other words, lay it on the line, let them know where you stand, and over time you will build confidence. And they will come to rely upon you.
If we don't know something, say you don't know it. That creates trust. We are obviously have more trust when we are successful, when we succeed in correctly projecting the outcome or projecting some type of environment which is going to occur or operation which will occur. And a consistent series of successes obviously increases their trust in the process and in the officer.
Ironically, no one planned to develop precisely the op intel system the Navy acquired. Instead, it grew organically, continually adapting to meet the needs of the Navy's complex and changing operational situation. One of the keys to good op intel is flexibility and adaptation.
You may find yourself in a completely different operation than you planned for. So the degree to which we are flexible in our approach to intelligence and flexible to the way in which we support operations is certainly very, very critical. And so situational dependence is clearly an attribute of our business.
When it's done right, op intel analysis undertaken with an intimate understanding of the needs of the operator can be an enormously powerful tool.
By virtue of working them together in the analytic process, you can actually generate the equivalent of new equivalent sources and methods. In other words, the cumulative effect of analysis is equal to new sources and methods. It's that powerful. The whole is greater than the sum of the parts in the analytic part.
What we have to be is flexible enough to see the trends and adjust and keep the baseline being the relevance part, and let structures come and go.
If you feel that anything that comes out of the computer or shows up on a screen is gospel, then you're making a big mistake. Frequently, what really counts is applying human judgment to it. And does this really make sense? What does this really mean? And is this what I want the boss to know? Is this what he needs to know?
Good operational intelligence analysis, moreover, requires doing this with as broad a range of information as possible. This is known as all-source fusion, and it is an indispensable part of op intel.
Every success I've ever seen in intelligence has been built around this idea of connecting it. If you don't have all-source knowledge, you go back into this tyranny of the stovepipes, which will produce the wrong answer.
It was at the height of the Cold War in the mid to late 1970s when we didn't have one or two Russian submarines deploy each year, but in the Northern Fleet we may have 200 or more Soviet submarines deploy, 5, 6, 7 SSBNs off of our east coast, submarines on a constant parade to the Mediterranean, submarines operating along with surface ships in the Norwegian Sea. It was a very heady time for the Navy and for naval intelligence. And for me, the ability to get a P-3 on top of or a submarine behind a Russian submarine, a Soviet submarine, to practice, to create peacetime situational awareness, to practice our wartime mission was really the height of op intel. And it was tremendously challenging and tremendously stimulating in that strategic ASW environment to convert a whole series of all kinds of raw data, ELINT, ACINT, imagery support, whatever it is, to a U.S. airplane or submarine or ship in contact with the potential enemy.
Fusion just isn't the result of a process that's ongoing. It's the result of architectures that have been properly built to move data. There's a timeliness, completeness, relevancy, connectiveness dimension to fusion as well. At the lowest possible classification, which is pretty much the warfighting demand today.
You have to take information and analyze it, determine first off what it is, and then you have to convert that information to knowledge by adding other subjective kinds of information to it. And then through the process of discussion and experience and intuition, you have to convert it perhaps into wisdom. So, and then act on it after you've done that.
Usually when you say all-source fusion, people generally conjure up a database, a set of screens, ebb and flow of data, some correlation analysis, resolution of ELINT ambiguity, resolution of comment ambiguity, trying to understand the situation. And that's all relevant too, but to me it's a much broader understanding. And I think where we probably did it best is in the OSIS nodes, Rota, London, Norfolk, Hawaii, and in Kamiseya in the Western Pacific, where those units specifically were focused on the needs of some operational commander. And in that case, you did whatever it took to get the tasking, to get the information, to cause sensors to get developed, to do the analysis, to come early, to stay late, because your total focus was to ensure the operational success of whatever mission you were supporting.
Because of the importance of fusing information from such a wide variety of sources, and rapidly distributing assessments to operational commanders in time to be useful in day-to-day decision-making, op intel has always relied heavily upon technology. In fact, the art of op intel has developed hand-in-hand with communications and data processing technologies.
It is the single largest problem, I think, that any intelligence organization has to deal with because of these volumes that we're talking about. We're talking about data streaming in at incredible rates, data that has to essentially be processed at a first and a second or third stage before it even becomes intelligible. Therefore, there's time bled off by the fact that the data has gone through that process. It then arrives at somebody who's going to analyze it as SIGINT and then perhaps push it out the door, and then it goes into an all-source environment where it has to be analyzed alongside all the other sources and methods. These volumes are simply staggering to think about. The answer, of course, is probably in, again, the end-to-end nature of the architecture. And I think this is where some of the services have problems.
Fortunately, just as good intelligence officers understand the needs of their customers, the engineers who developed the technological backbone of modern op intel well understood what Navy intelligence professionals did and what they needed. Later, with the advent of satellite constellations and computers, the need for and the fight for intelligence would reach into the still unfolding realms of outer space and cyberspace. But technology is only part of the story. At root, op intel is about taking all the information technology makes possible and creating assessments that meet the warfighter's needs. There is no substitute for good analysis.
One of the greatest dangers would be that if because of all of this automation and all of this availability of information, we ended up sending it all to the operators, the decision makers, directly, and making them serve as their own intelligence officers.
In the early 90s, there was a rush to censor the shooter, and there were advocates at the time who thought exactly that. It would just put the data in front of the operator, put it in the cockpit or whatever, and it will lead to quicker decisions and better operational application. Those people have backed off from that. They have seen what raw data clutter is like, and now they are much more interested in having assessed information. We can get ourselves wrapped around the axle here, though. There is a time and place for direct information feed to operational systems. And what we need to do is be very precise in our thinking about where direct push makes sense and where assessment and analysis is important and where pulling information makes sense. And we need then to structure our approaches so that we don't neglect the opportunity to provide timely information if it's going to be clear and relatively raw, as might be the case with some ELINT information. Then we ought to take the opportunity to provide that in a timely way without worrying about the fact that we have to look at each piece of data.
You have to take information and analyze it, determine first off what it is, and then you have to convert that information to knowledge by adding other subjective kinds of information to it. And then through the process of discussion and experience and intuition, you have to convert it perhaps into wisdom.
Well, I think analytical debate is good, not only good for the development of intelligence, but it's good for the development of analysts. It's good if people are strong in their convictions and open as well to other ideas. The process of debating the assessment or the outcome clearly can result in a better group understanding of what the problem is.
Analysis is important, though, because analysis done correctly does separate the men from the boys. There is something magical about analysis that is important to recognize, in the sense that if it's done correctly, it can be worth sensing, sensor means for the future.
Ambiguity is the enemy of the intelligence process. It's inevitable. It's there inside of everything. Even when you have perfect knowledge, which you rarely have, you still have ambiguity because what you're collecting against isn't certain about what they're going to do next. They're a living organism reacting to pressures. They may intend to do this, but if we do something, they may change their opinion. You have to be mindful of that at all times. Intelligence isn't done in large group gropes effectively. It's done by small groups of people concentrating on a problem and knowing everything about it and not being afraid to have massive arguments with each other about this ambiguity. We have a tendency to think if you throw a lot of people at a problem, you'll get a better answer. That's not my experience. My experience is throw three bright people at a problem and watch them tear it apart, and then feed them more assets when they need it. We don't have this knowledge. We don't own this system for its own sake. It serves a purpose to people who have to take actions, whether they're trade negotiators or diplomats or commanders of forces or guys in a foxhole or somebody driving a ship. They need information in order to perform their jobs with maximum effectiveness. We are part of the equation about how effective they are. If they are ignorant, that's our fault. And if bad treaties and bad decisions are made based on the fact that they didn't have information, or worse, they had the wrong information, that's our fault. Most of ocean surveillance, most of Opintel, is historic. It might be 10 minutes of history, not 10 years or 10,000 years, but it's history. It's what happened. It's only relevant to your customer when you can convert it into what it means about what's next. It's going to that port. It's got this cargo. It's going to join up with these three other elements and make itself into an even greater problem. That's what's important. And that has to be created by the human mind. Computers can help. I believe the automation of all of this is a tremendous step forward. But at the end of the day, I still think we're going to rely on gray matter packed inside of skull bone to figure out what it all means and why. And that's the essence of the job.
The good intelligence professional never forgets that even the best op-intel analysis is useless unless the warfighter gets it in time.
No, of course, that was General Schwarzkopf's major complaint about intelligence during Desert Storm, was that not that he didn't have enough of it, but that he didn't have specifically what he wanted, where he wanted it, and when he wanted it, without having to sort through bushels and bushels and bushels of information. One of the things which I tell my students in intelligence school, that the intelligence cycle is requirements, collection, analysis, dissemination, and you might think of adding a fifth element to that, and that is digestion, for lack of a better term. The staff intelligence officer on the staff of the commander who is seeking the intelligence has a major problem and a major role in the intelligence process to digest all this stuff and get to his boss those elements of information which really are important when he needs them.
In Desert Storm, unfortunately, we had accidental tank battles that occurred in the deserts of Iraq, where we had the data, we knew what the enemy was doing, but the Army was unable to get that data disseminated down to the lowest level. And that's another issue, is how far down is the data to be disseminated in the fusion process? Are we only servicing a command echelon down to, let's say, battalion level or task force level, or do we go lower? Intelligence has always strived, and over the years I've been in the business of intelligence, to try to push that dissemination process down and impact on the decision makers at lower and lower levels. And modern technology allows us to do that, but modern technology also provides us the challenge of having to deal with now a great diversity of inputs and the requirement to move that quickly in the face of a threat that might interdict our ability to do that.
It takes a special breed of intelligence professional to accomplish all of this. And it takes a special kind of relationship between intelligence and operations to turn good intelligence into operational successes.
If we don't have the trust of our customer, we're dead. Oh, we can be out here doing our business and working and thinking we're doing well. But if the customer doesn't trust us, we've lost the essence of what we're here for.
We don't have any intelligence battalion or any intelligence squadron or an intelligence wing or an intelligence brigade. We're assigned we're in the wing or we're in the squadron where we're assigned to the ship. And when we're junior officers, we are a part of ship's company, we're a part of the squadron. We bunk with and live with and interoperate with our operational brothers. And that's a huge advantage. You learn their culture, they learn your culture, you're friends together in a living situation as well as working situation.
It's more than just basic common sense to insist that good intelligence professionals know both red and blue forces. That is, they need an intimate understanding of both their adversary and their own operational customers.
We exist to support the operators, the decision makers. And that's what operational intelligence is. Intelligence to support operations. Pure and simple.
You have got to understand what's going on inside of operations. You have got to be as knowledgeable as you can be, I would like to say as knowledgeable as the operations officer, as to what's going on inside of operations. You're not likely to be that knowledgeable. But you have got to understand exactly what they are thinking, because if you don't, again, you'll be behind the power curve. You'll not be able to anticipate and provide the data required.
Whenever there's an operational intelligence problem, with few exceptions, U.S. forces are part of the picture. To some degree, what the adversary is doing is reacting to us. If we don't know what we're doing, then we misinterpret what the reaction is. We think the reaction may be initiative when it's the opposite. It's response.
Intelligence professionals must thoroughly understand their commander's needs and the context in which decisions will be made. Only then can they credibly and authoritatively provide him with relevant and timely information.
Some of this has to do with really knowing the target, really understanding your obligation to get down and dirty with the strategy, policy, doctrine, technology, tactics, organization, personalities, etc., of the threat, of the enemy, and to be able to frame that in as complete a way, package it in as complete a way for the warfighter. And in the context of the naval warfighter, we're talking about really every aspect of warfighting, whether it's planning, whether it's shaping the forces you're going to use to warfight.
Credibility is essential. If your boss isn't going to listen to what you say and use it as part of the basis for decision, you might as well not be there. Intel then is not relevant to the situation and to decision making. And then we're wasting our time when we're in that situation. So how do you develop that credibility? If you get into a situation where you've established a personal relationship and that credibility and reliance that so often is in part and parcel of the commander's relationship with his intelligence officers, now you really are in a position to be successful and for naval intelligence to be successful. That's an advantage that we don't have in the other services. In the Air Force, very few of their intel professionals are integrated in operational units. They tend to be separate structures, with a big component being in the rear and providing information to a small cadre forward. The Army military intelligence is organized in battalions and brigades, and while they are part and parcel of the larger organization, they are separate in the way they do business, and so you don't get that immersion that we're lucky enough to get.
You need to keep them very clear on what your mission is. What are we trying to accomplish out here? What are the limitations that I've been given on the role that I can play, so that the intel operator can understand what is important information for the commander to get in order to carry out his mission. So if I limited my intel operators to only responding to the things that I wanted, I would have a very, very poor set of information.
Many of those officers saw the way to be relevant to the Navy is to focus on operations to the point that they were always anticipating, even trying to stay ahead of the operators. And I know as a professional, that was a blessing and a burden. Blessing was you really got to be relevant to the operators. The burden was it meant you had to get there before they did, and you had to stay later after they were gone. So the price for op intel is very high in terms of the willingness of the individuals to contribute, spend the time, do the study, do the analysis, do the thinking, and so on. So I think it grew up culturally that the Navy goes to sea. When the ship goes down, everybody drowns, not just the operators, but the cooks and the intel guys and everyone else. So it tended, the Navy culture tended to push us together, and it tended to be a 7-day-a-week, 24-hour-a-day problem.
Those who think that the principal ingredients to good military intelligence are sensitive sources and high technology systems don't understand intelligence. What distinguishes good op intel from bad op intel is, most of all, the quality of its people. People build relationships. Analysis is done by people. And organizational systems are designed and maintained by people. As a result, it has always been essential to the successes of Navy op intel that the services attract and retain the kind of quality personnel capable of doing all this and thriving in a complex and ever-changing environment. So, what makes a good intelligence professional?
He's got to be able to say what he wants to say fast and make his point to capture the attention of his audience, and then he can expand on it if that's necessary. He's got to be able to get it out there, and he's got to stand up to it, because he's going to get commanders that say what he has to say is nonsense. When you've got something, you got to stick to your guns and stay with it and persist.
You have to have an affinity for this. And once you have the affinity, you then have to have the passion for it. And I think there is, passion counts for a lot anywhere, and being successful in any business, I think, requires that you have passion. It requires a strong work ethic, because intelligence is expected to be there before people come to work and to stay after everybody. It's a 24-hour a day, 7-day-a-week business, and it always has been. It requires that people be outgoing, and they're able to affect that connection with their consumer. The way we motivate people, the way we challenge people, even the way we recruit people, particularly in today's highly competitive environment, where in the 21st century there are a lot of other motivations that attract people into various and sundry careers, I think intelligence will increasingly have a difficult time to recruit the best quality kinds of people. And so there's a special obligation there to find the people who are genetically and passionately potentials for this business for the future. If you look around, an intelligence officer ought to always be bothered by what it is he doesn't know about the threat. That means that you don't just stand around worrying with your hands in your pockets fretting. It means that you're doing something about it. That you are looking for new sources and methods, new ways to get into the leadership of the political dimension, or the economic dimension, or the diplomatic dimension, or the military dimension of the target. That you are looking at the technology of the target, and you understand the threat, that you understand how that target's organized, that you understand the cultural, ethical, religious framework, that you understand the history of that target.
And I think any number of formal educational degrees can qualify you for getting started. Naturally, the technical skills now with information management, computer skills are quite helpful. But I believe, frankly, that a very solid foundation in history, in geography and social economic studies is also an probably even a better foundation. A good education in the humanities and understanding of history can really help you, I think, understand potentially the future. Not to undervalue an inquiring mind, you know, wanting to seek answers. An analytical mind certainly is good, but there are so many skills needed in the breadth of the intelligence business that we can take a lot of raw talent, and I think, and with hard work, form a lot of good intelligence officers.
There is one thing that distinguishes a great intelligence officer from a good one. Great ones are very close to their bosses and have achieved an ability to know what their boss is thinking and what they're going to think next.
The main thing is to have a good head, have a good head on your shoulders, be inquisitive, be forward in your thinking and able to project your knowledge and what you have so that the admiral and the operator will understand it and have confidence in your judgments.
For more than half a century of modern U.S. Navy operational intelligence, these vital tasks have required and have helped cultivate a special breed of professional.
I think it's a state of mind. I think being open, being inquisitive, being paranoid to a certain degree, not accepting things. My wife commented last night, as a matter of fact, we were talking about the situation in the Middle East, and she said, it's typical of you, always, that glass is always half empty. And I think that's probably true of intelligence officers. We are paranoid, if you will, and always that glass is half empty. I'm looking for the dark side of things. And looking for being inquisitive, but again, integrity, you've got to be able to tell it like it is and not be swayed by what people want to hear. And that takes a certain amount of courage. It takes a lot of courage, as a matter of fact, but it pays off in the end.
Intelligence is a service industry, and it is the intelligence professional's job not just to offer credible, relevant, and timely advice, but to make sure that the customer understands that it is so.
Our interpersonal skills must be good. We must be able to talk well, we must be able to be believable, we have to be complete, but more than anything else, have to be good salesmen. We are selling information. We are selling what we know to someone. They aren't paying for it in dollars. They're paying for it in attention. They're paying for it when they turn around and use it. I've never seen a really successful intelligence analyst who couldn't get up before the people they were working for, not intelligence people, but outside the intelligence community, and gain their trust and confidence and present the information in a way that the customer can deal with it.
I think evangelist or a preacher about intelligence is probably okay. I think maybe a social worker is better. Somebody who delivers a product as opposed to delivering the speech. And if you consider that an evangelist can tell you how you're supposed to live your life and all that, that's good to know. But the social worker who does the Meals on Wheels or whatever and gets out, interacts with the customer, and delivers the goods, that is really going to create trust and confidence and a desire to get more from the system. So I think we should be evangelical in the sense that we have a great product and we ought to talk about it, but we ought to spend more time delivering it, delivering successes, showing that we're proactive, showing that we understand requirements. Frankly, the proof is in the pudding. In regards to the intelligence business.
Because of the power of the op-intel process it developed during the Cold War, the Navy has played an important role in helping the U.S. military develop its joint intelligence institutions during the post-Cold War era.
Well, it's the wave of the present. Intelligence is perhaps the jointest of all of the things we do in the military. I don't know how we would have accommodated the downsizing that's occurred if we did not have joint capability. So it is with us today, and it is the wave of the future. And we are doing things jointly today in the operational sense and in the intelligence sense that we never dreamed about even 10 years ago. We have an investment in technology and investment in tactics, techniques, and procedures that allows us to federate and operate jointly.
Today, in the community of intelligence professionals, the uniforms are often referred to as being metaphorically purple, a blend of all the uniform colors of the branch services. All such purple intelligence professionals must work together in ways never before attempted, because the challenges of operational intelligence in the fast-paced, information-overloaded world of the 21st century are formidable indeed.
Yeah, there are two or three or four dimensions of intelligence support in the 21st century, which I think are refinements of the 20th century, but are probably important to mention. We've already talked about one, which is dealing with the information management challenges of fusion, moving data to the consumer, interacting and iterating with the consumer, particularly as a consumer, by the way, has a tendency maybe to want to think about moving the intelligence function to the rear. In the 21st century, there's going to be another dimension to this, which has to do with the fact that the information environment becomes much more ubiquitous. We're essentially living in a world where information is flowing over internets and intranets, and even the military is operating off a commercial off-the-shelf subset of not only the network and the computers that hang on those networks, but the telecommunications environment, both long haul and the distant end.
We have different different kinds of environments. A good example would be operating in support of a joint force in Kosovo. You know, one day you are projecting power into Yugoslavia, supporting carrier battle groups, supporting their strikes by them, supporting strikes by TLAM, supporting strikes by the Allied air forces, etc. And the next week, you may be supporting from the sea a brigade of Marines that are going in for peacekeeping operations and have to act as not just soldiers, but perhaps police, civil affairs workers, and all that sort of thing. The future of Opintel is transposing that Opintel mentality from a specific kind of war that the Navy prepared for to a broader kind of war that we support now, both in the Navy but also jointly, and to a broader kind of mission areas that we all have to support, which may not have anything to do with war, but have a lot to do with the operations other than war that we increasingly find ourselves involved with.
Opintel is, and always has been, a work in progress, a moving target that changes and adapts to the needs of our warfighters. The story of Opintel, therefore, is still being written by the Navy and in our present joint service environment. This is why it is vital to learn what lessons we can from the past, to pull from the Navy's rich Opintel legacy the keys that will help make Opintel continue to work in the future.
The issue for us is not to go out and preach the Navy ways. In fact, I sort of reject that approach. What we need to do is demonstrate the operational relevancy of the way we do business to operators. And if you do that, it's sort of like the ball field out in the middle of Iowa. You build it and it will come.
Good operational intelligence has always been important in warfare, but modern naval op intel was for many years unique in its scope and sophistication. Necessity is the mother of invention, as the saying goes, and the Navy's approach to op intel was forced upon it by trying circumstances. Japanese striking force had appeared seemingly out of nowhere and wreaked havoc upon the U.S. Pacific Fleet. Where was it now? What would it do next? And how could we prepare ourselves to combat it? At first, these were questions that had no answers.
It had nothing to do with the structure, it had everything to do with the relevance part. And what we have to be is flexible enough to see the trends and adjust and keep the baseline being the relevance part and let structures come and go.
The Japanese planned and executed the attack on Pearl Harbor without using any radio communications. So had we been very adept at reading their systems and following their activities, it's alleged that we would never have discovered their plans and intentions to mount the attack. Immediately after the commencement of the war, the naval security group stations and personnel dedicated themselves to a very major effort to make progress fast in the basic Japanese Navy operational communications system, which came to be known as JN-25. That was our designation of their primary system. And within a very few months, they made substantial progress in recovering additional code groups and being able to read many messages with a fair degree of intelligence, fair degree of text, so that by April of 1942, we were able to give warning to Admiral Nimitz about the advent of the movement by the Japanese toward New Guinea and what developed as the Battle of the Coral Sea.
Good operational intelligence has always been important in warfare, but modern naval op intel was for many years unique in its scope and sophistication. Necessity is the mother of invention, as the saying goes, and the Navy's approach to op intel was forced upon it by trying circumstances. The attack on Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, by the Imperial Japanese Navy on December 7, 1941, presented the U.S. Navy with an unprecedented crisis, one that required the utmost and timely, relevant operational intelligence on the Japanese fleet. The Japanese striking force had appeared seemingly out of nowhere and wreaked havoc upon the U.S. Pacific Fleet. Where was it now? What would it do next? And how could we prepare ourselves to combat it? At first, these were questions that had no answers.
It had nothing to do with the structure. It had everything to do with the relevance part. And what we have to be is flexible enough to see the trends and adjust and keep the baseline being the relevance part, and let structures come and go.
Let's go! Let's go!
Japanese planned and executed the attack on Pearl Harbor without using any radio communication. Because had we been very adept at reading their systems and following their activities, it's alleged that we would never have discovered their plans and intentions to mount the attack. Immediately after the commencement of the war, the Naval Security Group stations and personnel dedicated themselves to a very major effort to make progress fast in the basic Japanese Navy operational communication system, which came to be known as JN-25. That was our designation of their primary system. And within a very few months, they made substantial progress in recovering additional code groups and being able to read many messages with a fair degree of intelligence, fair degree of text. So that by April of 1942, we were able to give warning to Admiral Nimitz about the advent of the movement by the Japanese toward New Guinea and what developed as the Battle of the Coral Sea.